Assalamu alaikum, this is continuation of lecture number 23. So I was discussing about the effects of wind speed. The annual energy potential of a wind site cannot be estimated with the commonly available average speed data. So basically it rather involves a detailed knowledge of the probability distribution function and complex computation of its q power integral over the EF. Let me show you the formula. This is the formula, and it is a formula for root mean cube of a wind speed. A site with lower average speed can have higher energy potential if the speed distribution function has a relatively flatter curve. The wind speed variation with respect to time can be accurately represented by Weibull probability distribution function, which can be approximated by the Rayleigh distribution function. Since the wind power has a cubic relation with speed, the concept of RMC, or the root mean cube, has been developed and defined by this equation, and it was developed in 1999. All sites have the same RMC speed, which would have been able to have the same annual energy potential. An analytical expression shown in this slide has been derived that relates the RMC speed with the average wind speed. So basically it allows us to quickly and easily determine the annual energy potential by using the commonly available average wind speed data. It can also be used in a large scale computer model to estimate the annual energy capture potential of a certain region with known average speed graphs. So the annual average specific power generated by the wind are given by PRMC is equal to 1 by 4 times rho, where rho is the air density, and VRMC is the root mean cube velocity. With an average CP value of 50%. The annual energy potential of the site can be calculated by multiplying this power with 8760. So this is the comparison of wind farm sites which have same wind speed but significantly different specific power density. For example, for all the sites given over here, San Grongio, Gorgonio, Tiana Beach, and Culebra, they all have annual mean wind speed of 6.3 meter per second, whereas their annual average specific power given in watts per meter square is different. This one is the lowest and this one is the highest. Now I will discuss about the effect of hub height. The taller wind turbines the taller wind turbines have a potential to provide an additional clearance that is needed for longer blades that increase energy capture per turbine. So the wind speed V2 at a certain height H2 is given by the formula V2 equals V1 times the second height divided by first height multiplied raised to the power alpha, where V1 is the wind speed at a reference height H1, and alpha is the ground surface friction coefficient. The taller wind wind turbines also provide the additional clearance needed for the longer blade, thus increasing the energy capture capacity of a wind turbine. Recent research based analysis assessed that how the increased hub heights could impact the key indicators of wind energy across the map. The research looked at the factors of wind speed, the capacity factor, and the localized cost of energy, as well as incremental cost that could be incurred for increases in the turbine hub height. Hub heights of 110 to 140 meter could also offer localized cost of energy advantages relative to today's common turbine, which are presently in particular locations where the wind shear force is relatively stronger, including much of the eastern United States region. Another notable aspect of tall tower technology is the impact that the system innovation can have on the opportunities to increase hub height. As one example of more system-focused innovations, advanced controls have greatly increased the viability of tubular steel towers for economically achieving higher hub heights in the past year. So this table has the frictional coefficient with alpha of various terrains at lake, oceans, and smooth hard ground. The ground surface friction coefficient is low, and the city area with taller buildings have a frictional coefficient alpha of about 0.40. Now let's observe the effect of frictional coefficient area. So these are the graph on y-axis. It is the wind speed, and on x-axis there is the height in meter. So the smoother curves for alpha is equal to 0.10 is achieved for the smooth terrain, whereas the curves for the cities indicate that we have to go much higher at altitudes to gain a constant or regular speed limit. The winds at the surface areas of the oceans, for example, or the deserts have a constant speed, so the curve is relatively smoother, whereas the curve for the city at lower heights and as compared to the higher heights, the curve is nonlinear. This is basically due to the obscuration of wind due to in the presence of high buildings and other obstacles present in the cities. This is another example of wind speed variation at a certain airport in Mexico, which indicates that at lower heights, let's say it's at 500 meters, the wind speed is relatively around here 10, and it gradually tends to become constant when the height is increased.